what happens with these particular land use sectors is a key question for Canada's long-term sustainable future. You know, as we know, you know, a third of Canada's surface area is forest. That's nearly 300 million hectares. Forestry contributes about $25 billion to Canada's GDP and employs over 200,000 people. On the farm side, in 2016, we had about 190,000 farms, a little bit more than that in Canada, 158 million acres of farmland, and over $100 billion contribution to GDP, employing 2.3 million people. Bearing in mind that half of our primary agricultural production by value is exported directly as either primary commodities or processed food goods. So when we talk about land in Canada, and we have to talk about forestry, we have to talk about agriculture, and it impacts everything from our economy and employment through, again, to environment on multiple facets, whether that's biodiversity or greenhouse gas emissions. And we have large questions to ask about how are we approach production, food security, job security, while meeting the basic fundamental needs that we have as a society for these goods, as well as the needs that others have for goods produced here in Canada. And so the question we're really struggling with or thinking about and grappling with during this session and beyond the session is, what does the future hold for these sectors? What are the pathways to improving sustainability in all respects while meeting societal needs for food and bioproducts? And as I said, it's not just a question for Canada, it's a global question. And so I want to take a moment to introduce an initiative that I've been involved with for the last while that tries to tackle these questions, and was what led me to try to have this session as part of this SDG conference. That initiative is called FABLE, the Food, Agriculture, Biodiversity, Land, and Energy Consortium. And what FABLE consists of is over 20 country teams organized by a secretariat at the Sustainable Development Solutions Network, with support from the Food and Land Use Coalition and something called the Institute for International Institute for Applied Systems Analysis. What are these 20 country teams doing, which Canada has a team, and I'm heading that team? What we're trying to do is use a common modeling framework to develop sustainable pathways to 2050 for these major land use sectors that accounts for things like deforestation, biodiversity, water consumption, protected areas, greenhouse gas emissions, while being driven by the need for products, by diet, by our economy, by various other consumption patterns. And by the fact that we have these massive country teams for most of the major economies, we are able to then also incorporate trade to understand how both countries could try to achieve their domestic targets, but also how trade between countries allow us to achieve global targets overall. Because there's a very big question around meeting the SDGs, for example, as to whether or not they can always be met domestically. And so some countries, arguably, like Canada, have the resource base to have production beyond the domestic needs that we have. And that allows other countries to rely on importing some of these products in order to meet their domestic demands without having to scale up their production in a way that might be detrimental to some of the environmental goals, for example, right? And so for Canada, for example, we look at three scenarios: a current trend scenario with a growing population, diets that only change a little, little ambition beyond the current ones on deforestation, protected areas, and some modest improvements in productivity. And then we have medium and high ambition sustainability scenarios where we think about what happens if we have lower population growth, much healthier and lower impact diets, general improvements in things like crop productivity, and higher levels of ambition around protected areas, reforestation, deforestation. And what do our models show us? Of course, under our current trend scenario, we see very large increases in key commodity cropland for wheat, barley, oilseeds, for example. Some of that is increases for export. in particular to major export partners like China, for example. But some of it's animal feed for a diet that grows in meat consumption as well as a growing population. In the sustainable scenarios, by contrast, we see these shifting diets, lower population, higher productivity, and strong protection of land can actually reverse some of these outcomes in terms of land conversion, in terms of some aspects of deforestation. And so we see corresponding differences between the scenarios for outcomes of interest, right? Instead of having a tripling in greenhouse gas emissions to 2050 under the current trend scenario, we're able to see actually a sharp reduction in emissions in the sustainable scenarios while continuing to meet demand. These scenarios also have a lot of implication for self-sufficiency. If we define self-sufficiency simply as the ratio of production to domestic consumption, we see that Canada has the potential to be self-sufficient across most agricultural product categories, for example, with fruits and vegetables being an obvious exception. And interestingly enough, our modeling shows that when we go to a more sustainable scenario, we actually increase our self-sufficiency across the various product categories that we're interested in. And so in this modeling work that we're trying to do, it's not simply also a matter of producing a whole bunch of numbers. The key thing for us is also the creation of these scenarios, these pathways, and how these different sectors intersect with one another. So we're not talking about siloed pathways within single sectors. And we're really interested in engaging with policymakers, decision makers, and industry, and government, and civil society, and across different sectors to try to help develop scenarios that make sense for Canada and pathways that make sense for Canada. So if any of you have any interest in Fable and how you might get involved in the Canada Fable efforts, please do let me know at some point in time and we can have a further discussion. With that as a setup, maybe Sophia, maybe if you could do your session now.
Thanks, Hisham. So as Hisham said, I'm Sophia Murphy. I work with the International Institute for Sustainable Development, or IISD, as it's known, with an agriculture and investment program. And I just wanted to start with a few quite broad reflections. First, picking up on sustainability and thinking a bit about the political and social dimensions of sustainability to complement the conversation, which is often grounded, understandably, in environmental and ecological concerns and in the economy. You know, if we come and think about these pathways and what we're going to do, where Hisham in a way ended up in terms of what the conversation needs to be and how we build intersectoral connections, then I think we see some of that through the social or the lens that, or the issues that have been captured in the social pillar of sustainability. And I think the COVID-19 crisis is quite a good place to bring the conversation, because actually food issues have been in front of Canadians and others in an unprecedented way as a result of the pandemic and our response, the economic response we took to that, or the economic effects of our response. And there's some challenges that actually were impressive, some of the responses were showed how impressive our food system is, because we have been able to, after a few weeks of shortages in different particular products. Basically, the supermarkets didn't stop working, which is where most Canadians get their food. The food banks have really struggled, but have also turned around. Local food systems have turned around. And there's been a tremendous effort that has mostly resolved where people were getting food before, they're still getting food now, even with the changes and the abrupt closure of a third of the food spending, if you like, which was going into food service, that shut down with the pandemic responses. But what we see is some challenges that underlie the unsustainability of what Canada does with its agriculture and its food systems. One, I think most immediately and importantly, is the reliance of our production and also our processing of food on a large population of people who are poorly paid, disproportionately new immigrants, racialized, basically exempt from a number of the working rules and laws that would normally protect Canadians. And a business decision that's been taken by industries to keep open meat processing plants or for fields and greenhouses without providing the protective equipment that workers would need. And that's a truth of our food system in Canada, that we have a large number of people who work in very poor conditions in order to provide the food that we rely on. And second, you see in who is bearing the risk in the course of a crisis. And that risk bearing is very important also for sustainability and for imagining pathways into the future. So in the immediacy of the shock, you see that it's farmers who are left with unsold milk and unsold pigs and who are making decisions about what to slaughter and burn, what to maybe keep but store at their own expense. And they've turned to the government to help them. And we're grateful the government is somewhat responsive and has the money to respond. But you can see how this is actually a reflection of a deeper challenge in the food system, which is how profits are shared, where market power is concentrated, and what choices farmers have as to how they grow, what they grow, and where they sell it. So these land use questions are determined by a number of drivers, including unequal market power in the food distribution and production system. And so it brings you to these questions of who decides and at what scale decisions are made. And I think we'll come back to this in the conversation, I hope so, in terms of short and long value chains, for example, and what that introduces in terms of drivers and also regulations and obligations. I see Canada very much as a global actor in this and with responsibilities at different scales, but we don't have equal access to decision-making at every scale. And we're still trying to invent, I think, a better way to encompass. We have an economic framework that is globalized agriculture, but we don't really yet have a satisfactory political structure to do the same, although we have multilateral institutions. And of course, Canada is active in those institutions. Still quite difficult though for anyone making a production decision in Saskatchewan to know what is happening in a multilateral conversation somewhere, perhaps about pesticide use or about greenhouse gas emission limits. And I think that one of the opportunities maybe that's created by the COVID crisis has been this huge growth of interest in food, and it's been bubbling along. It's one of the drivers we come back to. I'm sure it's something that Hisham and the Fable Project have looked at, is what are people eating, where do they get what they're eating, and what are we thinking about diets, not least because we have quite poor dietary outcomes from a very abundant food system. So in the crisis, we've seen a renewal of interest in growing food and thinking about food and local sort of, you know, one of the ways to be busy in a pandemic seems to be to grow food. And I think it's not so much that that's suddenly Canada going to be self-sufficient in fruits and vegetables. It's more that it's Canadians maybe getting a different look at what the food system entails, what agriculture means, what the risks and benefits can be, and more open to a conversation about just what is happening in rural Canada, and maybe in also especially remote Canada and how their food systems work, and whether there are pieces of this that need to be rethought so that when we come back, we don't just prove resilient. I would say the food system has been relatively resilient in this crisis, but we're also beginning to transform what the food system does so that our longer term objectives in terms of ending the unsustainable nature of the greenhouse gas emissions connected to food, the nitrate pollution, the poor economic outcomes for workers in the food system, as we change that, how can we use COVID to change that, to realize those pathways? It'll be, I think, partly with a public that's asking for better things. Thanks, Hisham.
Thank you very much, Sophia. And so, Dominik, but hopefully your connection has improved, so maybe we can have you start again.
So thanks, Hisham, for the invitation to speak to everybody today about the forestry aspects and how they're linked with the sustainable use and the
forests, as I said, are very important to us in Canada. We are one of the most forested countries around the globe. And I think what makes us unique too is that we have over 95% public ownership of the forest, which I think has benefits and drawbacks. For example, in Finland, forests, I think, play an even more important role in people's lives, because everybody, almost everybody, has some forests that they own as part of their family. Nordic people in general have a very close relationship to the forest, and that is based on, you know, the need to be out in nature, to collect mushrooms, to collect berries, but also to have an economic income from the forest. So if somebody needs a car down payment, the forest is there, and they cut a few trees, and then that really changes the perception. And I think that's one of the biggest differences we're seeing to the conditions here in Canada, where we all collectively own the forests, and I think that gives it a very different perspective in the long run, how we manage them and how we see our forests. And I think that's, I have found to be one of the big differences in when we compare Nordic countries with the Canadian context, even though we have very similar forest resources. You know, when we look at sustainable land use, I think we've come such a long way. If I look at the situation in Germany, we were at some point where we didn't have any forests left. And that is really the initiating points for sustainable forest management. And a lot of the tools that have been developed as a result of this fact that we literally had no forests left because everything was cut down, that's where sustainability was born. And we are still seeing the effects of that today. I think we have also been in Canada we've seen a very heavy industrial use of forest resources, especially close to communities. And these communities have been depending on the forest sector, on sawmills, on pulp and paper mills, on other wood products that are coming out of the forest. So I think we've seen a very important role of the forest sector in general, all across Canada. But I think also we are seeing now that this is changing. If you Google forestry, sustainable forestry, there's lots of discussion about different values that we're managing in our forest today. And that is wildlife habitat, it's bird habitat, it's cultural sites, it's heritage sites. And so the demands to management, I think, have increased a lot, which I think provides challenges in some respect. It provides tension. But I think it also provides a great opportunity moving forward. And I think I'm coming from an operational background. It is up to us now to find new ways on how we ensure the sustainable land use, sustainable forestry in the future. And I think there is this really challenging tension sometimes that when you ask people about wood, everybody has good feelings. You know, they like their wooden floors, their toilet paper, you know, in this recent COVID crisis. So everybody likes wood products, but nobody really likes cutting down a tree. And I think that's one of those areas where we need to work on solutions to find the right path moving forward and how we balance those different demands to the forest. I think also when we talk about First Nations forestry, for example, forests play a very important role. And we have seen, especially here in BC, where more of the tenure rights, so that's the rights to harvest trees, have gone to First Nations, have gone to community forests. And then I think that's where we are seeing right now a lot of innovation is happening there, because a community forest, for example, has very different values. They need to build hiking trails and mountain bike trails. They want to create habitat. They want some set aside areas, but they also need to harvest some trees to have some income. We've seen community forests that have financed playgrounds, that have contributed to hospitals. So I think these are all ways we're seeing currently at the small scale what the future for the large scale can look like. So I think that's been quite a success story. And so where will we be in 2050? I think we are all aware that forests play a very big role in the bioeconomy moving forward. It's a very exciting time to be working in forestry when we, you know, are starting to be able to make cosmetic products out of wood and trees. We are making car parts. We are building here on UBC campus. We have, I think it is still the tallest wooden building in the world with 18 stories. So we're seeing all these exciting developments happening. And of course, they don't happen if we don't have the forests to sustain them. So talking about climate change is another really important issue when it comes to forestry, how we use the forests to bind carbon, to store carbon, how do we use it to minimize impacts on our climate change targets. And so this is all discussions that are happening now, and I think we need to find good solutions, and I think we are on a good pathway to get there to better manage the forest for different values across the board. So I'll leave it there. I'm happy to discuss more.
Thank you very much, Dominik and Sophia. I'm going to turn my video back on here for this portion of the session. So I think we're at 11:30. I wanted to ask a few questions of both Dominik and Sophia, I think, in terms of some of the things that you've already touched upon, but I want to kind of get to a little bit of a finer point of this. And one of the things that interests me with regard to these two sectors is the teleconnections, right? The fact that where production happens is different than where demand is in many cases. Sometimes that can be very small scale chains, but sometimes that can be really, really long chains as we talk about global markets. And so production is connected to demand spatially. And then this plays out into all kinds of debates around whether we should be producing more for local versus an import-export driven system, whether we should be looking at small scale production versus large scale production. Dominik mentioned community forests, for example, debates over land sparing versus land sharing. And so I guess what I would ask of the two of you is, you know, where do you see sort of a sustainable food or sustainable forestry system in 2050 looking like? Is it a system that is largely looking inwards within Canada, for example, for local production primarily through small scale, you know, visions of these sort of small scale production systems? Or do we continue to be sort of a large scale, globally oriented, export oriented player? And then what does that imply for our sustainability?
So there's a lot of things to that, Hisham. I would say in terms of that vision, and I think that it's probably a little bit of both, and both of them looking different. Mm. I think climate change is driving changes in what can be produced where. And I'm not an expert modeler, and a lot of things have to go into these models to know. But I was very struck by a paper by Fader and others that was saying, assuming that the sort of politics of trade allows, up to 1 in 2 people in the planet could be relying on an imported cereal for their staple food in 2050. And that would be because population growth happening in sub-Saharan Africa and in South Asia in particular are happening in areas where either climate change effects are expected to be most pronounced, or happening in areas where the land itself is not particularly or as arable as it is elsewhere. And there's a mismatch between our borders and our food systems that makes, to some extent at least, trade. Maybe the length of the chain is another issue, the extent to which this is a global system, which really isn't particularly now. It's international between certain things, like China absorbs a lot of food, also grows a tremendous amount of food. And some of that's to do with size of the country, and some of that's to do with recent changes in its policy. I suspect that will look different in 2050. But longer chains will probably continue. But I think that we see we have the technology now and the desire and the ecological need to have more local sources for our food, more diverse and more local sources as part of our self-sufficiency. And the self-sufficiency doesn't imply that it's autarkic. It implies that you have a combination of resources and money and technology to make choices over your food. And our food system right now is not globally all that stable, because a lot of people who need food have no effective demand in the markets that we've built. And that's one of the things we would want to redress. But I think to meet the food needs as a practical matter, we'll need different lengths of chain, and we'll need regulation that doesn't force. Right now you see in BC a lot of fights over raw milk, over local abattoirs, so for these scale things, we're going to need to rethink our food safety and our regulatory system to allow more space, I think, for those local answers, trading off some efficiency as we now define it in order to get more resilience.
Thank you. Dominik, if you wanted to add anything to that.
Yeah, I think where we are going to be in 2015 is very difficult to answer at this point, but I think it will be a combination. I think right now the forest industry in Canada is based on commodity products. And I think that's one of the big opportunities. It's been working very well for us, but it's also a big challenge, because right now the Canadian forest sector is very much dependent on the US housing markets for 2x4s, 2x6s, etc. So that is not going to change in the short and medium term. There will be a reliance on these commodity products going to they're going to the US. There's been an increasing amount going to Asian countries as well. So I think that is not going to shift fundamentally in the short or medium term, maybe in the long term, but we are also seeing more local value added production. And I think that is, a key when we, again, compare to small communities in Austria, we wonder, well, how can you run a sawmill there? And the reason is that they specialize in one product that where they create extra value. And I think that's a pathway for us moving forward. In combination with some of these, initiatives around First Nation forestry, community forest. And I think that provides such a big opportunity. We're seeing investments in mills that produce cross-laminated timber. It's where you take essentially small pieces of wood, you glue them together, and they're stronger than a big log. And so, as these technologies develop, as we can produce them locally, I think that provides a great opportunity. And right now we are exporting raw logs from the BC coast to China, to Japan, to Korea. And I personally think there is an opportunity, for more local production. Let's use those logs here. We turn them into products. But we need to make those investments, and we need a joint efforts by industry, by government, by local stakeholders to make these investments in forestry moving forward. We see opportunities with production of combined heat and power in small communities using the residues from fuel treatment. I think these are the kind of tools that we need to use more in the future, and to find these synergies that create opportunities for local communities, for employment, but also some economic income for those communities.
Thank you, Dominik. So we're getting close to the 11:45 mark here on West Coast time. We have two questions in the Q&A, so I think we'll move to those. And then a reminder to our participants that while I think the interpretation will end at 11:45, so in about 6 minutes, we will have another 15 minutes to engage in further Q&A if you'd like to stick around and chat. And then there's a separate sort of breakout room discussion session afterwards. So I have two questions on in the Q&A, which I think are really, really important. The first one regards sustainable forest management and how to value ecosystems. The intrinsic value of forest for Indigenous peoples is very different to the capitalist ecosystem services value, which different levels of Canadian government feel they have to work in, quoting from the question. So how do policymakers balance this and justify conservation when there's a pressure to develop these resources to pay the bills? So that's the first question. Maybe Dominik, you could address that briefly so that we can have time for other questions. That'd be great. So how do we think about these different ecosystem service values and how different people will value them very, very differently? One from a very monetary perspective, others might value it more from, let's say, a cultural ecosystem service perspective, which you can't necessarily put a dollar value on, these kinds of things.
Yeah, it is a very tricky or challenging question. And I think, unfortunately, I don't have a good answer. Going back to what I said earlier, what we're seeing with when tenure goes to community forests, for example, here in BC, I think that is, for me, kind of a small example on how this can work on the larger scale as well, because we have to balance. And as I said, it is more and more in the discussion. And I think it's a really important discussion to have. What are the values? What are the ecosystem values we want to attribute to the forest? And I think we have only seen it in the past from an economic perspective and an economic opportunity. Moving forward, you know, these different values become more important. And I think one way to maybe address it is to designate certain areas that where forest harvesting can take place, and we exclude other areas. I think it's dialogue, it's communication. We're seeing some of that happening across Canada. I think we mostly hear about the controversial examples in the news. That's what makes news. But I think there's also lots of good things happening where local stakeholders manage to balance some of those demands. And I think there is, unfortunately, no really a good answer to that question. But I think the opportunity moving forward is in dialogue. And I think we as Canadians have different demands for our ecosystem. Climate change is an unprecedented challenge that we have to deal with. And that new environment we have to adapt to, whether it is industry, whether it is NGOs, or whether it is government.
Thank you, Dominik. And we have another question in the Q&A, which is also forestry, but I think arguably some aspects of this might also apply in agriculture, which is how we adapt to the stresses of a warmer planet in terms of forest ecosystems, but also our agricultural systems. And bringing in the idea of assisted adaptation, which will transform substantially the ecosystems in ways we don't know. Are there other forest management strategies that are emerging to ensure our forests will survive the climate changes that are coming? And I'll just make a plug right now for some of the work going on within our Faculty of Forestry on assisted migration, both on the technical side by people like Sally Aiken, but also work by Shannon Hagerman and Rob Kozak and their groups on thinking about more of how this fits within the socio-ecological systems governance perspective and risk perspective, and how people might view those different types of management strategies. And so I would urge you to look up some of the work that they're doing on this. So how do we help our agricultural systems and our forest systems adapt to climate change, and how much should we be engaging in these sort of more interventionist approaches like assisted adaptation? How much should we be moving and thinking about actively shifting our cultivation practices, our tree planting practices, and these kinds of things?
Well, I think in forestry, it's probably more challenging because we are in so much longer rotation. So, what we plant now, we we will see whether that works. We know the answer to that in 40 years or 50 years or maybe 100 years. And so we the decisions, the nature of forestry, that is, we are in it for very long rotation. And I think if we go back, some things we have tried in Europe, some of them have worked really well, others are a miserable failure, and we are paying the price for what we paid 50 years ago. We are paying the price for it now because we planted monocultures that are now getting attacked by beetles or are affected by drought because we planted the wrong species on the wrong site. I think that's part of the nature of working in forestry. And as I said, Hisham said, there's lots of research going on how we can support the adaptation of our forests. But I think we also have to keep in mind, even without human interventions, the forests will eventually adapt by themselves. They are very resilient. And I think we can play a role in this, and hopefully we find the right tools, and there's lots of research that's going on, and it's a bit outside my core expertise, but I think the forests will adapt, we might see some more mountain pine beetle attacks, we are seeing more fires already, but I think we are also seeing lots of new management approaches and research on how to address these challenges.
Thank you. Sophia, did you have anything you wanted to add to that on the agricultural side?
Maybe just to say first that mitigation remains really important, especially for Canadians. And I see there's another question coming up, not to jump there, but you know, if we continue not to adjust what we're doing in agriculture, it's not sustainable. And there's good work on linked to the sort of planetary boundaries idea of looking at agriculture's contribution to a number of systems that the planet depends upon that are stressed by agriculture as practiced mostly in industrialized countries, but not only. I think in terms of adaptation, there's a great deal of experiment going on. A lot of countries, like France, is giving it the name agroecology. A lot of civil society organizations are looking at that. A lot of countries in Africa, and it means different things to different people. But this idea that you begin to think about your food system as more integrated into the local environment in a number of different ways, and you think about the foods that you get from your environment also more broadly, less focused on monocrops, less focused on an industrialized food chain, and looking at more diverse food as a result. It costs more, it doesn't necessarily produce as much food always. There's lots of questions, but it is definitely a place of experiments and adaptation. And there are plenty of ag systems in the world that are already adapting because they're already dealing with changed growing conditions as climate change takes effect. I think the last thing to say is that, and this is part of a project I'm involved in called Ceres 2030, that is trying to cost out the end of hunger and to advise policymakers on where to invest what I call foreign public investment. So the overseas development assistance that we have, how do you effectively use that for food security? And in Ceres, with the modeling work and the reviews of evidence, it's clear that one of the things is to keep on. You need to manage multiple scales at the same time. You need to deal with hunger here and now. You also need to deal with 4 and 5 and 10 and 15 year challenges. Your research and development will take a long time to pay off. Maybe not as long as the forest takes to grow, but it takes a while. And so you need to be able to kind of keep your resources and your attention on more than one time horizon. And I think that's really clear in the economic environmental fights that we have. You know, are we trying to protect jobs? What kind of jobs in what sectors, and what is the future of those jobs? Where do we want to be in employment in agriculture, in our natural resource sectors? And how do those jobs come into being? How do we make those sectors profitable? So keeping your eye on different time horizons, which is very difficult in our political system. And back to the points I was raising at the beginning, how do we adjust that horizon? Because our political horizons are very circumscribed in our democracy in ways I think that are not helping us with these challenges. Yeah.
I think that's a really big challenge, and one that we face across a number of sectors, where the decisions that we're making now lock in certain pathways, and the time horizon for our political change is very different than the time horizon for those lock-ins that we have that we implement, basically. You know, in the energy sector, we see the same kind of thing. We've got three questions in the Q&A. We've only got about 11 minutes. We'll try to get to all the questions, and please do add questions if you have more questions. Speaking for myself, if any of you have a question that we don't get to, please do feel free to look me up and send me an email, and I would be happy to try to respond to that if we don't get to your question. And if we get cut off quickly, I want to thank Sophia and Dominik for participating. I know we have a hard cutoff at 12, and so if in the end our conversations lead to us, I don't have a chance to thank them. I do want to thank you very much for participating in this, and thank you to the attendees for participating, and to the organizers of the conference for allowing us to have this conversation. Much appreciated. I want to answer this one question that was put here, which was, what would happen if we did nothing to adjust the paths we're currently on in terms of agriculture and forestry in the wake of climate change? And I would say part of that we try to address in our FABLE work. There is going to be a FABLE 2020 report that should hopefully be released in June or July with a chapter on Canada. I would urge you to look out for that when we release it, where we do address some of the implications of remaining on our current pathways. Largely what happens when we remain on our current pathway is we do see large expansion of certain commodity crops. Like I've said, this has implications for land use, including deforestation. And we see we really have a hard time meeting some of our goals and targets. Flipping it around, I think what the question is trying to get at is if we have sort of massive climate change impacts, and what would that look like? Dominik already mentioned some of the aspects with forestry. I think we see the potential for even further increases in wildfire. We see further increases in pest outcomes, like we saw with the bark of the pine beetle. In agriculture, there's, I think, some of the work shows the possibility of maybe some short-term gains in agricultural production as a result of longer growing season and higher temperatures, and maybe some expansion of the range in which agriculture can happen. But I would stress that those are, if they come to be, are likely to be very short-term gains and probably not long-term permanent gains, as we see the increasing effects of things like precipitation changes might make it much harder to take advantage of that, as well as the temperature regime getting into places where those beneficial effects no longer actually exist. But again, a shameless plug for the 2020 chapter on Canada from the FABLE report, which will come out in a while. And we did have a point in the chat that transition scenarios can lead to more favorable conditions for disease and viruses. And yes, that is also a possibility. So again, echoing Sophia's point that mitigation first is really the way the focus has to be in order to think about these problems. One other question that we can maybe address quickly is forest management in Canada and its relationship to the United Nations Decade on Ecological Restoration, which in turn supports the SDGs. And I will say that is also something the question of restoration, we touch on very briefly in the FABLE work. I don't know if Dominik, if you have anything you want to say about ecological restoration in the context of Canada.
I think these requirements are another layer of those values that I talked about earlier. So it's just another set of demand that we need to address. And I think to answer the question how forest management will change is that I think we will need to innovate. We will need to find new forest management strategies. We will use better technology. We will use more suitable technology. And I mean both on the harvesting side and on the management side. So we have LIDAR data, so we can much better see and understand where those ecological important areas are. We can better plan for water management, for all those different aspects that we deal with in forestry and forest management. I think this technology advancements that we are seeing, we are only scratching the surface at the moment in using them to our advantage in forestry. We're a bit conservative, but I think that's coming, and that will greatly help us in decision-making, and better decisions will lead to better forest management. And I think that if I look at it from a very positive perspective, that's what's going to happen. Forest management will innovate, will renew, and we will use the right technology in the right place.
Thank you. Thank you, Dominik. I'll point out in the chat, there is a link to the Coffee Connect session if you want to continue discussing these issues after this session is over, which will be in about 4 minutes. There is one more question in the Q&A, which I think is actually really quite interesting one. And that is the everyday experience for Canadians with both long and short supply chains. And I think the reason I find it somewhat interesting, and we don't maybe have time to get really into it, is that we often don't think about our supply chains when we go to the store, right? You go to the store, you purchase your products, and the supply chain, whether that's a long supply chain or a short supply chain, might oftentimes for many, many people be not a consideration or be invisible to them. Now, of course, we can sometimes look for that local product and be conscious about it and try to seek it out, or try to seek out the farmer's market and these kinds of things. But Sophia, I don't know if you have anything to say in the last 4 minutes about this everyday experience for Canadians with sort of long and short supply chains.
Well, it would be long supplemented by short probably, but for most Canadians, meaning they have an income and they live in a city, their experience of the long is going to be more choice, cheaper food, and sort of 24/7 availability of anything, strawberries, or, you know, no seasonality to what's there. It's also going to be waste, which is one of the things COVID-19 brought to the fore, is the amount of waste required in order to provide you with that food all the time, fresh as needed. That means a lot of gets thrown away. And the choice that you have on the shelf is then cut off rather abruptly because there are some fragilities in that supply chain that you don't control and that aren't controlled nearby. And then the short chain, you eat more what's in season. There's less choice in that sense. It often is more expensive. It's more difficult to allow demand to shape. You need a different negotiation between the producer and the consumer. But you have a different connection. It brings in a lot of the values that we've been talking about also in relation to forests. And you will maybe be more resilient in certain kinds of crises. You'll be more vulnerable to local pest infestations, local weather conditions, but you'll maybe also be more versatile when you have to stop supplying the school and you start supplying the food bank. You'll be in the same spatial place, potentially set up to make that happen more effectively.
Thank you, Sophia. So we have, I think, just a couple minutes left. So again, I want to thank Sophia and Dominik for taking the time out to participate. It's always great to talk to both of you. I always learn a lot every time we chat. And I want to thank the organizers of this SDG conference for putting this on and for being able to move from what was going to be an in-person conference to a virtual conference in a relatively short period of time, and have done a great job of organizing this and giving us this opportunity to have these conversations. And I know a lot of the other conversations that I've been seeing going on during the last couple of days. Again, I would invite those of you who have further questions or want further information to reach out to us. and we can certainly reach out to me and try to put you in touch with the right people to answer some of those questions or to hopefully answer them ourselves. And I think if there's any other, if you have any other final thoughts, we have maybe 30 seconds left, Sophia or Dominik, if you have any final thoughts you might have, then thank you for the attendees for participating. And I'll just say my final thought is, these are hugely interesting but challenging questions that are so vitally important on both the environmental side and the social side, as Sophia pointed out in her early remarks. So thank you.
Thank you.